everybody. We're going to get started now with our next panel. Are we ready? Georgia elections in 2020. I'm Jonathan Ringel from the Daily Report, and we're fortunate to have with us some key players in election controversies over the past few years. Starting immediately close to me is Bruce Brown. He has represented the Coalition for Good Governance, which challenged the 2018 Lieutenant Governor election and is pushing for paper ballots. Next to him is Josh Belinfante, who has represented the Georgia Secretary of State in some of these cases. Andrea Young is the Executive Director of the ACLU, which continues to challenge the state government on voting issues. And at the very end is my former colleague, Mark Niesse of the Atlanta Journal-Constitution, who has been covering these cases. Mark, I'd like to start with you. Early voting for the March 24th presidential primary starts Monday. What does the election litigation landscape look like, and what issues can you see coming that might send our other three panelists to see each other in court?
Well, it's very quickly moving. You know, there's always something, I believe, that the state is defending itself in at least eight lawsuits now, seven or eight, according to the Attorney General's office. Some of them might have been recently resolved, but there are always new ones coming up, too. We saw one just pop up on Monday in South Georgia in Superior Court there concerning voter privacy issues, and a judge ruled against an emergency motion for, in that case, just on, I believe that was Wednesday, so that was very quickly, but the underlying case in over voter privacy in Sumter County is still alive. But certainly there's so much happening, and it often ends up in court. Starting Monday, we will have our new statewide voting system that will be used by every in-person voter during early voting and on Election Day, March 24th. And you can be pretty confident that if there are problems, those will be folded into both existing and potentially new litigation. We already have lawsuits. There's one that people always think about is the Fair Fight Action lawsuit filed after the 2018 governor's election by Fair Fight Action, alleging broad problems in elections administration, everything from long lines to voter registration to absentee ballot rejections and so on. There's also the ongoing litigation in federal court concerning our security of voting on our electronic voting system. Those are the two most prominent cases, but there are a lot of others, some of them dating back to 2018, again, dealing with these issues of absentee ballot rejection, signature matches, citizenship verification. And what I expect to happen is that if there are significant problems in this new voting system, those may well end up in court too.
Okay. I'd like to ask the rest of our panelists to try to answer this question, which is, are we ready? I'll start with you, Josh. Are we ready for elections?
Sure, and I have to give this caveat. Any answer I give you today is not on behalf of the state of Georgia, the Secretary of State, or any other government client which I represent. So with that, are we ready? Yes. No, I mean, I'll provide some more detail. I mean, look, there was a lot of concern early on about whether the timetable to get the voting machines out to the counties was realistic, and the machines are in the counties. People are ready to vote on the machines in the counties. And so that aspect, yes. And we'll see what happens in the presidential preference primary. But in terms of is the state ready, it certainly seems so.
Bruce?
One of the reasons why the state will be ready is that litigation against it was successful in having the state commit to a backup plan. And so that if it cannot use electronic machines, for some reason these new machines fail or they don't get them set up, the state is supposed to be ready to use hand-marked paper ballots. And so there's a Judge Totenberg ordered the state, in our case, to develop a backup plan in case these new ballot marking device systems don't work or there's some other problems with them. In terms of the readiness, one of the more recent concerns that have been raised by my client and by others is that the state has a law, a good law, that was passed in connection with the legislation authorizing the purchase of this new equipment to require the state to have one machine for every 250 electors in each precinct. That was to address not only the number of machines, but the distribution of the machines, so that you wouldn't have one precinct have more machines than another, and long lines, and one that didn't have enough machines. As a result of that, that drove the number of these machines that the state purchased for about $70 million. And the difficulty is, what the state is learning, I fear, is that these machines are gigantic. The screens are about 22 inches across. And when you vote on them, anybody in the room can see them. And Georgia law, the Constitution, and statutory law requires absolute ballot secrecy, something that doesn't appear in either the federal Constitution or, in, oddly enough, in the federal common law. This is a state-created right, particularly. And the ballot secrecy command is absolute, meaning no one is supposed to see who you're voting for a lot of very good reasons. And these screens are so big that if you walk into a room when anybody else is voting, you can see who they're voting on. So if you vote on Monday, you should be very careful because people can see who you're voting for. So we think that's very bad. The state in response is saying, well, we can position them in a way, you know, back them against the wall, put them in a corner so that people can't see it. Well, if you do that, you can't fit them in the room. And so
isn't somebody just standing in front of it like this screen here? Wouldn't that cover it? I mean, somebody behind me couldn't read this screen.
It's much bigger than that screen.
Okay.
And many people are much smaller than you now. And so, we have photos of a large man standing voting, and you can see right over his shoulder in a demonstration, you can see right over his shoulder who he's voting for. And not only can you see who he's voting for because the font's so damn big, the bar where your choice is lights up. And it goes like this. So it's like you're voting on a jumbotron. And what the interesting thing about how, you know, you wonder, how did this happen? How did a manufacturer not think of that? You know, did you think of this? Like, one thing you're supposed to do is allow people to vote in secret. And they didn't do that. The reason why they didn't do that is the machine is designed for people who are visually impaired when they first developed it. And it's very good for people who are visually impaired. So the visually impaired person who knows Braille goes up to the screen, gets a wand that has Braille on that you can feel, and can vote on it, and the screen goes black. So for a visually impaired person, the jumbotron is black. But the blind person, the visually impaired person, can make his or her choices. But if you don't know Braille, you're out of luck. Anyway,
was that the issue in Sumter County?
That was the issue in Sumter County, but you're going to see that coming up next week and in the weeks to follow as the Secretary of State tries to figure out how to jam all these machines into these small precincts, which, the places of which are fixed by law. It's too late to move the precincts.
Josh, I see you writing. You have a response?
Yeah, I mean, I think what you'll hear in both that and what you'll hear probably generally today is there's really not a one-size precinct or polling location, I should say, in Georgia. So in some polling locations, you're going to be able to get the machines exactly as Bruce described, where their backs against the wall, and that takes care of it. And I was not in Sumter County. I don't have a client there. But my understanding is, and Bruce can probably speak to this much better than I can, that part of the challenge or part of the reason for the judge's decision down there is that there are things that can be done. There's privacy screens that can be put on top. There's curtains that can be put around, and so some of that are things that I know folks are looking at now. But it's not a one-size-fits-all in terms of what your polling location looks like, and those of us who have voted in different polling locations in Georgia probably certainly know that. The other aspect of that is what you find in a lot of the voting litigation is where one side tells you to do something for a particular reason, the other side tells you it's flawed for another, and the government is stuck in trying to choose which policy of various choices is the better one to do. So let's take, for example, that question of polling locations. Some folks say that we should open more polling locations, or counties should open more polling locations, so as to cut down on lines. Other folks, sometimes in the same litigation, will tell you that if you open up more polling locations, you'll obviously have people voting, more people voting at new polling locations. And when you ever change someone's polling location, that that leads to a drop off in voting participation. And so again, you're in a kind of situation where you can make one side of the house happy and upset the other. The point is that all of these decisions that we're talking about, or at least certainly a lot of them, are policy decisions made at state and at county levels. And they're made by policymakers who are there to make those kinds of decisions. And the challenge that we've seen in a lot of litigation generally is trying to adapt a one-size-fits-all when you've got 159 counties all running elections within some discretion that, that they're providing.
Andrea, what are your thoughts on all this?
Well, at the ACLU, we don't take a position on the machines. We're concerned about the overall attitude and accessibility for all voters. I grew up in Atlanta. My first campaign, I was 15 years old. My dad was running for Congress, and we campaigned at the bus stops, right, with the women who would come downtown, change buses at 5 points to go out to their job on the north side where they couldn't be late. They're riding the bus, they gotta prepare for their kids. So we look at what is the readiness, what is the accessibility for those folks. And what we've seen, you know, what we see in Georgia is that there's not a voter friendly attitude. We get there's a lot of concern about people who are not eligible voting, and not as much concern about people who are eligible not having a fair opportunity to vote. So we really, our view is that it should be every voter, it should be easily accessible, and every vote should count the same. And in that respect, Georgia is not there, which is why we continue to litigate. There are, Mark has done really important work on reporting a lot of these issues. We haven't seen any place where there's been a proposal to change a polling place that was giving a net gain in polling places. Down in Randolph County, there were 9 polling places. They were proposing to close 7 of them. You know, Fulton County, ahead of the mayor's race a few years ago, was going to close polls in and consolidate precincts in overwhelmingly African American jurisdictions, you know, ahead of what was a very close mayor's race. So there are constant challenges of people trying to just stay on the ballot, duly registered voters who a few years ago, 160,000, many of them in ERA that we had restored. Most recently, we did work with the Secretary of State's office and the bill that includes the voting machines extends the time for purging to 5 years from 3. Nevertheless, the Secretary of State, you know, rather than taking the spirit of the legislature, which was to extend the time, took off around 300,000, just last year. So we're constantly battling to keep people on the rolls. And, you know, if you are a low-income person without a car, you may not have Georgia has one of the strictest voter ID laws in the country. We were one of the first to have it. And so there's just not an attitude of, we want to make sure everyone has a fair chance to vote. And that's what we're fighting for. We want people to be able to walk into the polling place, you know, in their community with their neighbors and sort of celebrate democracy. And not have, but instead what happens in Georgia is somebody checks your photo ID 3 times as if you're trying to cash a $10,000 check. You know, it's just the atmosphere here we've got a lot of work to do. We did see last night that the Secretary of State has started running a video that shows people voting on the machines. But if any of you all have ever waited in line behind those little things where you have to stick you're trying to get out the parking lot and you're trying to get the little coupon into the slot and make sure it's, and how that, you know, so I you know, we have no position on the machines, but, you know, I'm a little concerned about the mechanics of how this is going to work. And we've got three really important elections this year, March, May, and November, and hopefully not January of 2021. But these machines are going to get a lot of use really fast.
Andrea, you mentioned the 300,000 people whose names mm-hmm. were taken mm-hmm. off the rolls mm-hmm. in December. Mm-hmm. How many of those people, what sort of response have you seen from people saying, hey, I shouldn't have been taken off?
Well, you know, I think that, you know, the issue there had to do with the 3 versus 5, right? So the legislature just passed a law, you know, just extended the time that it should have been, you could do 5 years before this kind of cleanup. And yet these folks were done, you know, technically they could be done under the old rule of 3 years. And so, you know, it's a challenge, because if you're not taken off and you finally realize, oh, it's a presidential year, I want to vote, you could go on the Secretary of State's app, which we've been promoting, go on the app and update your address. Because what do we know about poor people in Atlanta with gentrification? People are constantly moving, chasing affordable rent. So, you know, these are folks who were duly registered. And, you know, if you're, again, Metro Atlanta is 10 counties. If you're in Fulton, you might move to Clayton, again, chasing affordable rent. In that case, you are technically, you know, you can be pushed off. But, you know, if we are actually concerned about making sure that everyone who pays taxes has a fair opportunity to vote and it's not overly burdensome, you know, the other question of what's burdensome is very different, you know, if you're riding the bus and picking, you know, and to work and versus, you know, driving and having the flexibility to go to work late. But from the perspective of, you know, the service economy worker in Metro Atlanta, many of these things can be very burdensome. But we've been encouraging people to go on the Secretary of State's app, which is great. You know, you can check, you can sit in the barbershop and check everybody there. You can check their registration and make sure, help them make sure that they know where they're supposed to be voting, update their address. But Metro Atlanta Georgians and Metro Atlanta people are very mobile, and technically, you know, people in Metro Atlanta don't really think about the, you know, their neighborhoods in Ellenwood, neighborhoods in Buckhead, where you can move across the street and you've gone from Fulton to DeKalb County.
Right.
You know, you've gone from, you know, Moreland Avenue, you go from Fulton to DeKalb County. And those folks are technically, you know, able to be taken off the rolls. Yeah.
Mark, what have you seen and what have you heard from readers on these things?
There is broad interest that from regular readers about elections in general, and that often falls along political lines where, you know, the response I hear from more conservative people, they're concerned more about election security and fraud, where people more from the left side of the spectrum are more concerned about foreign interference and voter suppression. But they are unified in all wanting our elections to be accurate. So as different as they are in exactly what they're concerned about, they are all concerned and interested. And I think that makes a lot of sense in Georgia, where I expect us to have record turnout in November. Secretary of State is predicting 5.4 million voters out of 7.2 million registered. That would be a tremendous turnout. By comparison, we were about 3.9 million in the 2018 governor's race, and that was a record for a midterm. And then there's beyond the broad interest, there are people who are very specifically interested in their issues. There's a group that works with Bruce Brown that is advocating very strongly for hand-marked paper ballots, and they are some of the most involved and active people both in court, at the legislature, on social media, at community organizations. And that's a smaller group, but they're very intently involved. And while I have the microphone, I want to touch on something we were talking about just a minute ago about the privacy issue. It was so interesting in the state election board meeting this morning. I was at and covering, where first you had, we had almost 2 hours of public comment. And first, a group of blind people came and talked about their difficulties with the new system, with how the instruction said, push the red button. And they're like, how am I supposed to know what the red button is? Or it kept playing on repeat over and over again. And they were saying, enough, we got the instructions. And then after that, some of the people who won paper ballots filled out by hand came up and started talking about the privacy issues and saying, oh, these screens are so big and bright, anybody can see them. And then the blind people started booing. So it really shows the diversity of opinion and needs from voters with our new system.
That gets to kind of what Josh was talking about in regards to there's no one size fits all. Bruce, your client, the Coalition for Good Government, really wants a paper ballot. I was curious though, is litigation the best place to find that, or is that something that they should be supporting a candidate for legislature, or secretary of state, or governor to run on that position?
There's no cause of action to force the government to adopt paper ballots per se. That's not a claim. What the claim is that the particular voting system that they are using is unconstitutional for one reason or another. And that one option that the state has is to use Hamar paper ballots. Now, the Hamar paper ballots is the gold standard in the United States. It's used throughout the country. Very, very few, I don't know if there's any other state that has the entire state all electronic like Georgia does. And so that's probably, that's a policy decision. Right. And so now the legal issues that we've gotten into have not been to force, it's not a cause of action to force the state to use Hamar paper ballots. However, the claim that we did raise against the old DRE machines was that those machines were so potentially infected and so frail that they placed an unconstitutional burden on the right to vote, and Judge Totenberg agreed, and that order was not appealed. And so that's what she held.
And those machines are now gone.
Those machines are now gone, and then replaced with these new machines.
Okay.
So it's a we're not the legal action goes to enforce the constitutional guarantee that there are no barriers to voting that do not have a substantial government reason. And a lot of these machines are just those barriers. But then legislature, that's a whole different
thing. When you talk about paper ballots, are you referring to something that would be akin to what the old SAT was, filling out with a number two pencil or a pen, A, B, C, D, and you slide that?
Yes.
Slide that. So
yeah,
no punching of cards like Hayne, Chaz.
No. And actually, the state uses them now for provisional voting and for absentee voting. All we're saying on sort of the policy side of this, not necessarily the litigation side, although sometimes it bleeds over, is just have everybody do those. Mm-hmm. And that's how it's done in most of the country. Now, the important thing is most of the new system that the Secretary of State purchased would remain if you used Hamar paper ballots, because as Josh knows, that the entire system is very complex and very expensive, and only one feature of it is the voting stream that you actually mash your choices on.
Right.
There's the election management system, there's the scanners, there's the tabulators. They're very expensive and very sophisticated. And the new ones that they have are much, much, much better than the old ones. And so you would just leave that existing infrastructure, use paper ballots, fill them out, stick them in the scanner. It's easy. You don't have to worry about privacy. You can have, and then you would have one system, as they do everywhere else in the country, for the visually impaired.
Josh, what are your thoughts?
I think you asked the right question, which is this a issue for the judicial branch or an issue for the legislative branch? And I would suggest that it, again, on behalf of Josh Belinfante alone, that it is an issue for the legislative branch. All of these, you know, I was glad to hear Bruce say that there is no cause of action to adopt Hamar paper ballots. The trick is that that's the remedy that they always seek in the litigation. So in some ways, it's the same thing. And what we find is, and we can all look at this, when you involve Hamar paper ballots, you just get a different set of potential problems with voting. And the Supreme Court of Georgia ruled on this some time ago in a decision, I believe it was Favorito, where they said, you know, the legislature has chosen in that time to go with what was then called the DRE machines, the old machines that we had. And yes, there are problems and potential problems with a DRE machine approach. There are equally going to be problems with a hand-marked paper ballot approach. And again, that's where it gets down to that policy decision, where legislators are in the best spot to make that decision, where individuals in Georgia, organizations in Georgia, have the opportunity to make these arguments, and they did, to the legislature and get them to adopt a different standard, which the legislature chose not to do. But I think that, you know, I think that is part of the crux of the issue, and it makes it difficult to fashion judicial orders given all of those issues that are there. I mean, we look at the order that came out in the curling case, the voting technology case, the most recent one, not the one.
This is the one that got that ended up getting rid of the old machines.
I'm talking about the 2019 order.
Okay.
So the one that came out roughly last fall. And some would say, if you look at that order, it effectively adopted what the state did, which was get rid of the old DRE machines, move to a new system, implement that new system as soon as possible. And we have, when the machines go down, you vote on a provisional ballot, and as Bruce indicated, a provisional ballot is a hand-marked paper ballot. And so in some ways, Judge Totenberg's order did not change what the state was doing and really allowed the state to implement what the legislature had mandated last session. We're seeing this will be the first major election. We did a pilot in various counties and some cities this last time involving the machines, but the presidential preference primary will be the first one where the machines are used in total, and we'll see what happens with them. But to suggest that one version of voting is always better than another version of voting, I think ignores that you're always swapping one set of problems for another, and the legislative branch is the one best situated to decide between the two.
Andrea, you mentioned campaigning for your father, Andrew Young, and of course we know that he worked on civil rights demonstrations that led to the passage of the Voting Rights Act. We also know that 7 years ago the U.S. Supreme Court struck down a key part of that law, which required states like Georgia with a history of race discrimination to have changes in voting procedure pre-cleared by the Justice Department. Are the controversies of today, I mean, I don't remember this much election litigation right. in the past, are they a result of that Shelby County decision?
So I'm trying to think if one of the first times I met Mark wasn't in the Huddle House down in Randolph County. When they had a proposal to close 7 of the 9 precincts, not surprisingly, all the 7 included the ones where most African Americans voted in the county. And so in under preclearance, the ACLU and other, you know, partner organizations could have, you know, essentially sent a letter. You know, that would have had to been submitted to the Justice Department, and we could have sent a letter to the Justice Department explaining that, you know, the adverse impact on black voters, and had it resolved, you know, in a fairly, you know, in that sort of manner. Instead, in the absence of preclearance, we had to do the legal work, be prepared to file in federal court. We had a media blitz. We had people organized to go down to Randolph County, and to their credit, the Board of Elections down there did give notice and did have 2 public hearings before they voted. So they had good procedure in that sense. We along with other organizations, civil rights organizations, packed both of those hearings, sent people, you know, to testify about the adverse impact it would have. We had all kinds of media coverage, including the AJC, and then finally, when it came around time for the Board of Elections to vote, they sort of met for about 1 minute and said, "We won't be closing any precincts. Thank you very much. Goodbye." But all of that effort, I mean, it was 6 weeks of like we did canvassing to alert the community. We had petitions, because under Georgia law, if I think 20% of your voters in a precinct object, and you can't close it. So we had all of these different things to ensure that that this happened. Now, Georgia has 159 counties. You can't do that every time. You know, every time this happens, that's sort of the burden. We have litigation also in Americus around the school board lines, which were changed after Shelby. That litigation has gone on for 6 years and is still, I think there's still being judicial conferences about the school board lines. So, you know, so it's an incredible burden. And the, I mean, the folks, with the Voting Rights Act, people were very, very conscious about poor communities in the South having the resources to actually defend their voting rights and raise these issues. That's why preclearance is so important, because the counties that are affected, Irwin County is another place, we have Valdosta, you know, these are places where the affected communities don't have a lot of resources. They don't have lawyers who are, you know, at liberty to bring these kind of cases, and so, or have the expertise. And so it's an incredible burden on these communities to not have the preclearance requirement and basically not have the Justice Department on their side in making sure that their access to the ballot is being protected.
Josh, when you were counsel to then Governor Sonny Perdue, did you work on the preclearance issues? This was before the U.S. Supreme Court decision.
No. No, never had a chance to do that. The closest I got was that the state, through the governor, filed an amicus brief in one of the Texas energy district cases, and that was it.
Oh, okay.
I never did
more. All right. We have about 5 more minutes. I'd like to ask all of you, what does a successful outcome of the election look like? Of course, not partisan question. But what would, you know, if November 15th rolls around and there's not a runoff coming, you know, what would make us say, well, that worked out? Can anybody respond?
That's a question I'm asking to election officials.
That was Mark's question.
Because, you know, we're talking about a whole new voting system used by, again, 7.2 million registered voters, and it's a lot of pieces of equipment. You know, 30,000 new touch screens, a new printer for each of those, new voter registration tablets, and new optical scanners and ballot boxes. Things are going to go wrong with this much equipment, this much voters, all being used for the first time statewide. So how do you judge what is a disaster and what is expected? And what I've heard from election security experts is it's a disaster if it's something statewide. If it's something that's systemic, that affects broad numbers of voters, that's a real problem that shows that the system wasn't ready and that it's affecting people on a broader scale. But we can't expect isolated problems. We can't expect people to forget to plug in certain pieces of equipment and then run out of batteries. We can expect problems with voter check-in. We can expect poll workers who don't know how to use the new equipment despite, no matter how much training they might have gotten. With lack of experience comes problems. But what, and I'll report on whatever problems there are. But we know it's bad if it's systemic and if it's across jurisdictions.
Bruce? I think high turnout and universal or near universal acceptance of the accuracy and legitimacy of the results.
Right. Any other thoughts?
It would be great to see an election that did not have long lines. And, you know, long lines make for good media coverage, but the things that result in those lines are the kind of problems that Mark is talking about, that, you know, there weren't enough machines, there are not enough poll workers for a location. People got misinformation about where they were supposed to vote. They have trouble getting through the process. They're not getting their provisional ballots if they're not on the on the rolls. And so we are very concerned about the adequate preparation and the long lines, because for people who are hourly workers, long lines are a denial of the right to vote. And we saw that in the governor's race. And, you know, I think if we see that again, you know, in what is sure to be a very close race. And we've talked about the sort of statewide races. We've got two Senate seats, but we also have, you know, a General Assembly that will have a lot of close races. And so there are a lot of really important races at stake, and people need to have, really need to have ready access to the ballot and not have long lines and a lot of anxiety and a lot of problems at the polling place.
Do we have time for any questions?
Okay.
Does anybody have a question they'd like to ask? Yes, ma'am.
I'm in Lanier County near Valdosta. Our city Our city mayor has taken issue with the fact that the county has moved into a new building to set the stage for all these new machines, and has negotiated holding the city elections in a place of his choice, and he being the one to regulate that. What in the new system allows that?
Does anybody know?
The attorneys might know better than I, but the new system doesn't speak much about polling places. It's largely a county decision. And without the clearance provisions of the Voting Rights Act, the Department of Justice doesn't have any say in it either. So polling place locations, as I understand it, are entirely within the jurisdiction of the county governments.
After 2016 and 2018, I've become very distrustful of those in charge. This is like a two-part question. One is, when I took a look, I went in to double-check my registration, and I got the voting thing, and it's like they've separated federal and state. They've created almost like seven elections, which to me is sort of a repressive way, because how are you going to get people out to vote seven times? I don't know if that's the exact number, six or seven. The runoff for federal is in January of 2021. For state, it's December 1st. It makes no sense. So I'd like to hear that. The second part, a friend of mine who's voted in every single election going back 40 years got one of those postcards. And I said, you've got to go in and get checked. But she should never have received one of those. So it's very, you know, I think there is really active ways of removing people off the rolls, and I just would like to address them.
Anybody want to take that one?
Well, you can see me after for your friend who got the postcard. I mean, I think, you know, that one of the challenges is that, you know, when you're dealing with 300,000 records, you know, mistakes are made, and mistakes were made. They were made when we checked it, you know, a couple years ago. They were made this time, I think, but, you know, from what we could tell, a smaller number. But again, in races where, you know, decisions are being made by a few hundred voters, a few thousand voters, you know, making mistakes on, you know, a few thousand registrations, you know, is a real problem. And as I said, there's not this sort of deference to say we want to err on the side of not ever preventing an eligible voter from casting their ballot. Like, that doesn't seem to be the standard that prevails right now in election administration, that they would rather err on eliminating people, even though, you know, you can count on two hands the proven, you know, in-person voter fraud in the United States of America. So, where the penalty that's being paid is far greater than the risk of in-person voter fraud.
Okay, I'm afraid we got to wrap up, but I want to thank everybody for listening, and certainly want to thank our panelists.
So we're going to take about a 10-minute break and be back in for a look at the Atlanta Olympic Park bombing.
Great, thanks.
What's it down?
Yeah,
this is great. They replaced all my legal pads. That's how remarkable. And it feels like you're writing on. It's called a marker. But it keeps all your pads like folders on the PDFs.
That really looked like a pen. I mean, I thought that was legal.
It's like the balance.